Hello, everyone. Welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. If you're following me on Spotify, I really do appreciate it. Links down below. And of course, join us over on Patreon. I do one-on-one calls. We do live shows. I'm very excited to talk about today's episode because it correlates so well to our past episodes. But before we jump on to that, look out to the left, or I guess your right, you'll see my Dragon Ball Z mug. This is my latest mug. We need a big mug again today, and no extra teapot, because today we are using a tea bomb. Oh no, I just realized. Oh no, the Etsy shop's name isn't on their packaging. Note to self. But this one does say Youth Berry. I'll put the name of the company down below. I'm not sponsored. I just go on Etsy and I look for tea, and this is the tea that I found. I've had one other of their chais or their teas, and it was really, really good. And so they put this little saran wrap on it. Oops, I don't know if you can see, but there's like a real flower on top. There's flowers in the mix. There's this gel flavoring around, and inside is the tea bag. So you put it in your hot water. Okay. And here, we'll put the saran wrap over here. And then a little container. Cute. And then I've got one other flavor here. They come in packs of four, at least the ones that I bought. And so it just goes ahead and eventually melts in there with the hot water. So I'm just going to let that do its thing. I should have brought a spoon. Oh, it smells great already. Oh, just like a beautiful berry smell. Perfect for the fact that I have one version of the famous strawberry dress. Do you guys remember last year, I made a video about Tess Holliday, and I said, your girl gonna get that version of that strawberry dress somehow, but the real version is hundreds of dollars, and I can't justify hundreds of dollars on a strawberry dress. But I got some knockoff options, because the internet is full of strawberry versions of dresses. So this is the one that I picked up. I think it's really cute. It matches my pink watch very well. Now, today's episode is about people seeing you. How do you know someone is really seeing the real you? Or if you're seeing the real them, and whether or not your friendships, your loverships, your partnerships, whether or not they're actually built on like a real I see you versus a I am dreaming of the potential you. I am dating the fantasy version of you. Well, I want to tell this story. I've told it, I think, a few times on the live shows, but I want to just have it here officially. I remember in my mid-early 20s, I was working at a grocery store, and I was working with just the most interesting group of humans. I worked grocery for many, many years until I became a professional nanny. And then when I was a professional nanny, I went from that to YouTube. So I've had an interesting little eclectic collection of jobs, and I've met a lot of really interesting people. Well, when I worked at this one grocery store in Orange County, there was this woman who worked there with me who was middle-aged and in her 40s. Very nice person, very lovely, just like a really genuinely wonderful human. She was not what you would call feminine. She was a masculine presenting cis straight woman. She was Mormon. She had a son. She was divorced. She was very kind. And I could tell with somebody who people didn't necessarily get along with, she had a lot of walls she would put up. So of course, me being me, I got to know her. We became friends. And I remember one day I came to work and I had bought a new car. I traded in my old car for a new car and I was really excited. And I told her, oh my gosh, I got a new car. I'm very stoked. And she asked if she could drive it. And I said, yeah, of course. And she goes, what? No, I was just kidding. I would never assume I could drive someone's new car. And I was like, it's just a car here. And I gave her the keys. I said, look, your shift hasn't started yet. Mine has. I'll stay working. You go drive my car. I don't care. She goes, really? And she, like a child, ran out of the deli. We worked in the deli together, covered in grease, ran out of the deli. She was so afraid she was going to like stain my new car. But I've never bought a car with the idea that it wasn't going to be a camping car. So, you know, grease spills and oil stuff is just like no big deal to me. So anyways, she was so sweet. She took off her shoes in the middle of the parking lot. This is her telling me this part of the story because I was working my shift. She takes off her shoes, puts it in the parking spot where the car was, and just takes off driving around the neighborhood a few blocks. Very adorable, just giddy with just joy, as if, I don't know, I presented her with like the greatest Christmas gift, and it wasn't even something she was going to take home. It was just a car she was borrowing for. Anyways, I just thought it was so interesting. Well, anyways, one thing led to another, and this woman and I became friends, and we saw each other at work. We did spend time at Disneyland together, and that was basically the only time we'd really see each other outside of work, until one day she asked me if I would go to temple with her to their church. I think they call it a ward in Mormonism. She was a Mormon, is a Mormon. And I went with her to Christmas celebration. It was really cool. I'm glad I got to do it. Of course, she knew I was an atheist, but at the same time, I'm always open to visiting people's places of worship because I think it's a really great opportunity to learn more about humans. and the people that I love in my life. So over time, needless to say, we became close. Now, for me, because I am who I am, whether it's a person on YouTube or just a very warm person, I suppose, with people, a lot of people tend to gravitate towards me more than I gravitate towards humans. And because of this, I am used to people wanting to be my friend because they see how much I see them, which makes sense. Humans want to be seen, want to love and be loved. So when she approached me one day and told me, "I love you." And I said, "Oh, you're so sweet. I adore you too." She goes, "No, I'm in love with you." And I said, "I'm sorry. Hold up. Brakes. Gay skirt skirt. Are you not a straight woman? Are you not Mormon?" And she was like, "Yes." And you can imagine that as a divorced woman who's been straight all her life in her 40s, this is very hard for me to say. "I love you. I'm into you. I want to be with you." And I looked her, I held her hand and I said, "Honey buns, you're not in love with me. You're in love with the idea of me. You're in love with the fact that I see you. You're in love with the fact that I'm nice to you and the fact that I let you drive my car, go to Disneyland, or hang out with me in a way that makes you feel seen and warm and loved as you should, because that's just how I treat people in general." But over time, and she was my greatest lesson, when you show that you can see people too much to people who have never felt that, they become attached, like a parasocial relationship. A YouTuber who seems like she's inside your head, making content just for you, and the idea that you guys aren't meant to be together seems outrageous. Only this woman was somebody I knew in real life, outside the camera, and she still, because I had looked at her in a way that nobody had before, showing her, I guess maybe to her, just like an insane amount of kindness, it must have been something more. And eventually I had to separate myself from her. She became very in love with me, like wanted to put me in her will. And I told her, you have a child. Give your money to your child. You know you won't see me again. This is not where our journey is supposed to go. And I understand. I really do. I've met so many people who feel so unseen. And a big part of it is that we don't even know ourselves, let alone how to present ourselves to the world so the right people will meet our most authentic self. It's very complicated. Okay, let's try this tea while we sit with that story. Oh, the bag inside the mug is so beautiful. Very good color scheme. I'm very excited. I didn't realize the packaging. These packagings don't have any details on them really. So I'm kind of bummed about that, but... Oh, there's a flower that almost... I'm not going to lie. I eat the flowers, like the loose flowers. Oh, that is so good. 10 out of 10. Really recommend. There's little flakes of flowers on the table. Now, I don't know if you guys have ever eaten wild flowers or anything like that, but I grew up doing that as a child. You know, you would take daisies. Are they daisies? Or maybe not daisies. What are they called? What are they called? The little yellow ones that you can eat the stem of. It's kind of sour. Dandelions. Yeah, dandelions. That's what it is. Not daisies. Dandelions. So as a child, I used to chew on dandelions with my cousins because I guess our parents used to do it in Iraq. And so we learned it from them. And of course, any of the wildflowers that are in the teas, like I do drink, even if they tell, like, I'm not sure that they tell you not to. I assume it is okay because it's edible. It's in the thing. But it's such a weird concept. It almost makes my brain want to stop. Like, oh, you're eating flowers. There was a YouTuber, I forgot what her name was. She's Asian and has a very like extreme sense of fashion, very like dark, but like pastel. And she used to eat roses. And she made like lipstick out of them or some sort of stain. Anyways, I haven't watched her in years, but I hope she's doing well. But I just remember like that distinct visual of her eating rose petals. Okay, let's see. Every time I go to smell it, it just smells so good. So what is my responsibility to this woman who fell in love with me? What is my responsibility with anyone that wanted more from me than I wanted from them? I'm not sure yet. One of the funny lessons I've never learned in life is wanting someone more than they've wanted me in terms of romance or sexuality. So my friend, actually, him and I had this discussion about how I've never been broken up with. Like, I've never really been broken up with, right? I've never had anyone tell me no first. I've had people ghost me. I've had people do things like that. But if you're willing to ghost me, like, you were never that important anyways. You know what I mean? Like, you're probably not somebody important to me because no one important has ever ghosted me like that. But it is one of those things where I do wonder why people fall infatuation with certain people. I wonder that about myself. I don't always know why people declare their love to me. Even recently, I had somebody who wanted to go out with me and I said no. And then they asked my consent to convince me to date them. And it was a girl. So like every time we have this idea that like, oh, it's a men's issue or a women's issue. No, I've had much weirder experiences with girls in love than men in love. Men are relatively simple to me in terms of their desires. Like they're pretty out there with it. They're pretty like, yeah, I want to do that. Versus girls, there's a lot of like maybe, maybe not, which I understand. As a girl, I completely get it. Sometimes we need to see people in different boxes to understand the context of their character. Sometimes we have to talk to somebody for a while to understand them. I'm not even upset about it. This is not a criticism. I think the fact that we're all discovering things about each other differently is not bad. I think we just need to learn to communicate those differences so it's not so confusing. So, how do you know when somebody really knows you? And how do you know what steps to take on your end to make sure that you're not also deceiving them, but you're not giving away your privacy? Actually, one of you asked me to make a video about boundaries, but I actually think this moves into this subject very well. So much of how we interact has to do with how much we understand ourselves as well. One of the things I've noticed, and we're, you know, 2020 was a weird year, so kind of like minus 2020. But prior to 2020, one of the things that I noticed about subcultures and the reason that I moved away from all of them was because they tend to be a place that eventually end up sort of a... In the beginning, they always start off for the people who genuinely want it, so they work really hard to make it happen, whether it's BDSM or a D&D group or anything else. But then over time, if it becomes too popular, it just becomes a place for loners to socialize. So what I've discovered through all of my subculture hopping from one group to another is that it always starts off for the people who are genuinely seeking it out. And eventually, because word gets around that they're cool people or inviting people, the people who have social awkwardness or can't socialize certain ways show up to these groups just to make friends, which is not bad, again. I mean, I know people who are even thinking about going to church to meet people, which is pretty common. I've had a lot of patrons who are atheists tell me that they were interested in going to church. I think that is so valid. I think it is so necessary to have communities, and that is not the issue. The issue is you might not know why you're there, and so you might not know how to communicate that to people. I've met so many people at the BDSM dungeon who were wallflowers, and when I went up to them and I said, hi, welcome to the dungeon. My name is Brittany. Welcome to our community. Are you new? Can I help guide you through this process at all? They were like, oh, yeah, I read about you guys were inclusive. You were socially acceptable for people who, you know, come from different backgrounds, and I wanted to come hang out with some people that were cool, but I'm not really into this kink stuff. I don't like that. I don't like that I've met a lot of people at dungeons who just want friends instead of actual BDSM friendships or interactions. And at the same time, I don't want to be one of those people who disregard the fact that a non-BDSMer could show up to the BDSM dungeon as a part of their journey to know themselves, because sometimes I have escorted vanilla people into the dungeon. I have taken accountability for them, maybe not understanding the rules, and I have helped them try to feel more comfortable in the space to see if it's something they liked. And that's different. I think if you're exploring subcultures to see if it's something you like, that's great. But many of us in the BDSM world know that there are many types of kinksters, but one particular kind is a person who lives for the dungeon life. They work for dungeon life. They literally do school for dungeon life. They socialize for dungeon life. Their whole life revolves around dungeon. And with 2020 shutting down dungeons, a lot of people had to reassess their priorities. And no offense, but BDSM or anything outside of the self, if that is your whole primary focus, even above who you are internally as a person, I think it will come crashing down. Because if your existence is predicated on something someone else created, even if it's a historical context, then you're not living for the present you. And the present you isn't dictated by the past or the future. It's by the person that, you know, who's experiencing life then. So my concern is people who take on the burdens of past historical oppression, people who are minority status and feel this is necessary, people who want to keep lineage going, people who have an obsession over something that's not coming strictly internally from themselves is a concern to me. Again, if the world outside is what dictates the world inside your head, then you're not going to be able to fully function in a whole person sort of way, because we are not always interacting with the world outside. Right now, I'm not even interacting with you in real time. I'm pre-recording this podcast that will eventually go on the internet when I'm probably doing something else, and you'll be watching it interacting with that Brittany on a camera screen and not the Brittany who's me in real time, unless you come to the Tuesday live shows, which I do at 3 p.m. every other week on Patreon, every other week on YouTube. So if you guys can visualize, I suppose, that understanding, that difference between the outside you and the inside you, I think it will help understand who's seeing you and how you're seeing other people. COVID really was a challenge for a lot of us. I mean, a few of my friendships are rooted in BDSM. And if we don't have these dungeons and we don't share each other's politics and we don't share each other's worldview, then we have to make sure that when we reconnect, we're reconnecting on who we are today. Because 2020 did not stall my life. Because I kept growing and gaining money and meditation and focusing on my family and moving forward, because my life didn't stop during COVID, or at least I tried not to let it stop, a lot of people who remain stagnant, like, oh, I'll just bunker down and for 3 months do nothing. Oh, I'll do this for 5 months. Oh, I'll do this for a year. Well, they might be coming out of COVID in a completely different state of mind. Like, I know some people felt like this year didn't count, so they're kind of repeating this year. I'm not doing that. I'm not in that headspace. I don't believe time stops for anybody. I believe not counting 2020 is probably less healthy than more healthy, but it could be a coping mechanism. I don't see it as a big deal. I don't think my life was on hold. I don't think life itself was on hold. I think that's what they told us so we could pretend that time didn't get wasted. But we wasted a year, and they let you do that, and you did it. And it's interesting that people just were fine with it, fine with wasting a year, and I wasn't. So the people who can see me, who understand me and know what I'm doing, they know that time waits for no one, and I'm most certainly not going to wait for time. I'm just going to keep doing my thing, right? That's because I live in my own head, in my own bubble that I've created, because I've chosen it. I have free will. I've made a decision. Everyone else has their own destiny, their own journey, their own desires. And when you go on this journey, you will meet lots of people who pretend to see you, who do see you, see parts of you, see all of you, see none of you. It's so interesting to me that the three people that are in my inner circle who are not related to me are three very different people, and all three of those people are uniquely weird in their own bubbles. They see me and accept me for exactly who I am, even when they disagree with me, even when we look at each other like, what you say? They will take time to know me because they know the context of my character. This is a big deal for me. Allowing non-related people into my inner circle, allowing them to stay in my inner circle, to tell them everything about me and to feel not afraid that they're just going to abandon me, took years, decades. I've known all these people a very long time. And I think I have to double check how long I've known the last person to enter the inner circle, because I've known him the least, but still, he's somebody that I can just tell anything to. And same thing, my best friend's coming in next week. She's going to come stay with me. She's got her vaccinations, so she feels safe to travel. So she's going to come stay with me. And same thing, I've known her 20 years. I can literally say absolutely anything to her, just absolutely anything. And she will be like, uh-huh, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Again, telling her things about myself. This is very special. And I always ask her, how do you think we maintained our friendship? And a lot of it has to do with both of us unconditionally loving each other and both of us also trying to be good for each other. Because remember, we talked about this in the last episode with the narcissist. You do not want to have people in your life who see parts of you but abuse you so much, or toxic for you so much, or maybe good people but are bad for you so much that it's actually causing more harm. You want to grow with people who grow with you. And this could mean that other good people you know might not be ones you grow with. I know a lot of people who aren't in my inner circle who are wonderful, wonderful humans. But if we tried to bring each other into each other's inner circle, we would hate the other person because the other person isn't the right energy. And I know energy sounds woo-woo, but stay with me here. Everybody has like a vibe to them, an energy to them, whatever you want to say, that when you're around them, they drain you, they give you spoons, they, you know, make you feel on edge, they make you feel comforted. you should listen to these feelings and then weigh them against the logic of your brain. Be reasonable, but also don't disregard your gut. It's interesting. I've been doing this thing where I've doubted my gut for a really significant time in my 20s. And I still have that hesitancy now. And I recently tested it out a little bit. I had made a judgment with my gut, but I couldn't back it up with the logic. So I had to like reach out, get the logical reason I didn't want to do this thing, and then weigh it against my gut. And yes, my gut was still right, but I didn't have the evidence to prove why my gut was right then and there, but I knew it was. And so this is an interesting sort of tool to use, but it's hard to create, like it's hard to get a good gut. But at the same time, it's your subconscious giving you information, right, that you might not be totally aware you've even had stored. So it's like this fine balance. Do this when you meet people. Weigh against the logic of your gut with everything else. There are so many people who feel pressured to go on dates they don't want to go on, hang out with people they don't want to hang out with. Don't do it if you don't want to. But don't do things because you want to remain stagnant. This is the balance of becoming an adult. When you grow up, when you start to actually take on responsibility, i.e. making choices, you're going to have to make a choice. Kiyoti says this all the time to me, that by not making a choice, you're rejecting responsibility. You should make choices when, you know, and sometimes I do it too. Sometimes I'm like, I'm going to make no choice, or I'm going to make a different choice. I'm going to weigh out my pros and cons. Nothing I'm saying here is a one-size-fits-all answer, but they are minimal tools to use when interacting with people. Okay, so you're sitting across from somebody who sees you. I'll give you an example. I was at the BDSM dungeon and I saw this gorgeous nine. And you have to understand, the BDSM dungeon is full of wonderful nerds, but I don't really see nines and tens of the dungeon. I'm just going to be honest. I'm going to say it right now. Like, objectively, you look at them and you're like, holy shit, but this guy was like a nine. And I was like, hello. And he was gorgeous. And he was in the rope community. The funny thing about rope, and seriously, no judgment, I can hear the rope riggers right now getting a little... If you're a silk person, a rope person, and you show up at BDSM dungeons to be able to do these things, but are not kink, no judgment. So I was at the dungeon one time, and this gorgeous nine was there using the ropes and silks area, and he was kind of the king of this little group, and he was gorgeous. Like, he stood out to people because he was so pretty, and he was very skilled in what he did, and he had a lot of play partners. And one day he approached me, and I was like, shooketh. I was like, oh my God. Oh my God. I was just like, oh my God. I was like shook. Okay. So he approached me, we started talking, and he made my topside come out so fast. So I'm primarily a bottom, or if you're in BDSM, I'm primarily a submissive / brat. Okay. Mm. Oh, this tea is so good. And he was a switch. And so, and I'm a switch for the record, but he's like a big switch. So anyways, he approached me, we started talking, and I found out that he was interested in playing with me. And I was like, great, what made you want to approach me? And he said, well, I like the idea of like a girl, you know, especially a smaller girl than I am, because I'm pretty small. I'm like 5'1 and 135 pounds. And he was like, I would love for you to peg me. And I was like, oh, God bless America. Yes, please. I was very excited. I've always wanted to do this. It's like a dream. And I was like, yeah, totally. So we start talking. He comes over to my house. I'm partnered at the time. And like, I was poly, so no big deal. My partner's in the other room. I'm with him in one room. We're fooling around. We're getting to know each other. We're mixing energies. I'm having a good time. He seems to be having a good time. It seems like it's going well. We want to negotiate to do a checklist. So we exchanged, you know, numbers. We make a plan on the text to like hang out and then get tested and do all the stuff we have to do. And then he doesn't return my text messages. And I'm like, oh, that's weird. We had such a good time the other night. Like, I really felt like we saw each other in this particular way. Like, I've never, you know, we just moved really fast. It was like within a few days, we were all of a sudden just like, really, the chemistry was fucking good, right? Well, then he ghosts me. And I'm like, oh, that's so weird. And then I see him at the dungeon, of course, because like, it's a small dungeon. Like, you know, we all see each other all the time. And so I see him and I go, hi. And he ignores me. And I'm like, oh, what is this? And I'm like, this is weird. And then we're in a group, like a social setting, where all of our friends and him are there. And he will not talk or look at me. Like, he's ignoring me. And I'm like, what is going on? And I was just floored. I was so confused. I was like, what did I do? Could not figure it out. I messaged him. I said, hey, I saw you at the dungeon. I know you saw me. I don't know why you're not talking to me. I'm not going to cause a scene in public. I'm going to take this as you just like not wanting to talk. I don't understand it, but okay. And I never talked to him again. Yes, I would see him in the dungeon, ignore him. I would see him at events, ignored him. I never got an answer from him. Just like a grown man who just couldn't tell me that he wasn't interested, maybe, or maybe he wasn't feeling the chemistry. So maybe that is my example of rejection, but I don't really count it because he wasn't important to me. So I just don't, you know, he's just like a guy I knew. And that was the problem. In my 20s, I was so desperate for a chosen family. I was so desperate for people who saw me. I was so desperate to go dark with BDSM. I'm an edge player. I was so desperate to find people to go down this path with that any line of chemistry, any spark was like a potential long-term something or a long-term play partner or a casual friend. But either way, I was reaching. I was going. I was trying to find those people. And every time I thought I got close, it just wasn't right. And I kept trying to figure out, like, why aren't these people becoming my guild? Why aren't I finding my cool little clique, like, in every story that exists of best friends who go on adventures together? Why am I going from one group to another? I've been having this problem since I was a young person. I was a conservative. I had conservative friends. Ditched. I was in high school. Ditched. I was there. I got ditched. And I'm like, oh my God, it's me. I must be fucking retarded. Like, what is wrong with me that I'm losing all these friends? Even on YouTube, I'm like, why don't people understand me? And a big part of why people think I'm autistic is because of this, but I promise you, it's not that I'm autistic, but I think it's something along those lines of when your brain works differently and you communicate differently and you see the world differently, it is a very lonely process. And I know a lot of people feel like, oh, because I'm gay or queer or neurodivergent or all of these things, I'm going to connect with people who are also like this. But that's not true. Just like modern feminism does the whole like third wave feminism is like women should stick up for women and trans people should all stick up for all trans people. Like, get over it, guys. We're not all friends. Some of you are shitty people. And some of you are good people I just don't fuck with, you know? So here it was just like totally confused. And what I came to the conclusion of is like when you are weird, like truly weird, it is a lonely process. I know a person who's just the sweetest, most wonderful, like just most lovely human in the whole world. And she asked me the same thing. Like, why aren't I getting along with other women? Why aren't I getting? And I'm like, oh, you're weird. Do you not know you're this weird? And it's because weird people like myself, I assume I'm not that weird. I don't feel that weird. In my everyday life, I don't feel weird. I get along with every single kind of group that I hang out with, which tells me that I'm generally acceptable to people. The only time I get alienated is when I go a little bit more intimate. I let down a little bit of wall and I let the world know some of my thoughts. Though funny enough, I think the reason why my audience is so dope on YouTube is because it's a collective of really weird people. Like people who have stuck around for reasons I don't even know. But I talk to you guys on Patreon. I talk to you on our one-on-one calls and I meet you and I've told you, like, not all of you. Some of you are great and wonderful and normal, and I love that about you. But some of you, a few of you specifically that I'm thinking of at the second, and I think you know who you are because I've told you specifically, like, you are so weird, and I love that about your brain, but you're weird. And I think we need to own when we're weird, and uncomfortable, creepy weird. And we know these people exist. I actually am working on a video about why it's so easy to make fun of BDSMers, and it's because we're weird. I mean, look at the way I'm dressed, okay? Look at the way I'm dressed. Look at, do you see this heart? Do you see how it's actually like, it's beating and it has a light inside of it? A woman at a dungeon made this for me. Well, she didn't make it for me. She made it and I bought it from her. But when this woman asked me, she looked at me and said, how much do you think this is worth? And I said, oh, I don't know. How did you make it? And she explained it to me, but I didn't understand the process at all. Like, I was a really young person and I was like, what are you talking about? And I was like, I don't know. And I was thinking that it was just like cheaply made or something. And I told her I thought it was worth $20 because I was thinking with a capitalism brain, mass produced necklace, probably made with parts from China, you know, this somebody saw at the dungeon, came up to me and said, oh, you have one of blankety blank's hearts. And I said, oh, yeah, she sold it to me for $20. And he goes, $20? And I go, yeah. And he goes, oh my gosh. He goes, these are worth like at least over $100. And I was like, really? And he explained in better detail for me to understand how it's made. And I was like, oh my God, if I understood that, then yes, easily, especially as somebody who creates things herself, I know how much money and time goes into things like this now, but I didn't know at the time. When we assess people, whether it's how much they're worth or if they're like us, we can only use the information we have. We cannot know more than we know. So when we're judging people, even people we think get us, we can only judge them in relation to how we understand ourselves and the world around us. When I entered BDSM circles and nudist circles, I thought these people woke as hell. They're experiencing life in a hedonistic and wonderful way, in an enjoyable way. And I thought they must know something other people don't, because look how comfortable they are in their bodies. And the truth is that some of them do. Some of them do know things that other people don't. But a lot of BDSMers are twos. If you guys don't know what I'm talking about, the two is a part of a 5-step level system that I created as a philosophy, an observational philosophy called the levels. Links down below. You guys can get the summarization and then watch the long form video if you want. I really, really recommend it since I reference it a lot of my content. But there are a lot of people who are, you know, this is why twos are A, Bs, and Cs, guys. Two Cs are people who understand the bubble they live in okay, but maybe not are great at surviving in it, but they get by. Level Bs are the people who understand their bubbles and even more of like something's going on. Like the Joe Rogan, something's going on. But then you have the people who actually know what's going on, like the Bidens and the Nancy Pelosi's, people who actually have our secrets. Like, are you not shooketh right now that Dr. Fauci's talking about how it was most likely made in a lab, like coronavirus? And I'm sitting here laughing. I'm like, oh my God. I love it so much because it just shows how much the populace is convinced so easily to do things because a couple hundred people in office said to do it. Love it. Love it. Whether you're, you know, marching on the Capitol because someone said to do it, or taking vaccine because someone said to do it. Either way, you're doing it because someone else told you to do it. And so you have to be very careful if you're trying to jump from the two world to the 3 and 4 and 5 world, understanding that in order to do that, you have to disregard the idea that someone else can know better than you, except when you know they do. And this is key, when you know they do. One of the reasons I love that I get to pick my doctors and, you know, fire doctors and hire new doctors is because I want a doctor who's actually interested in medicine. I worked for a cancer doctor. She loved her job. She loved everything about cancer, understanding cancer, how it worked. She wasn't just somebody who like spouted off what she learned in school. She thought it was very interesting. I trust those people, people who love the subject they're in enough to really know it like the back of their hand, because this allows me to know that they're not just interested in finding whatever answer is easier for their laziness, but actually interested in like trying to problem solve, because that's what I'm like. I want to know the problem solving, you know, of all these things. So how do we problem solve getting to know people and people seeing us? You need to read. You need to socialize with people. One of the things that I think my job does for me that other people's job doesn't is it puts me in front of a lot of people. You know, I deliberately do phone calls on Patreon so I can meet people and talk to people and learn from you as much as you're learning from me. I want to go to conventions, not because I, Brittany, want to be at a convention, but because I, Brittany, want to talk to people. Not to make friends, not to find lovers, but to literally... I kind of want to study you guys, but not really, but kind of, because in order for me to understand myself, I have to people watch. I loved going to Disneyland and just watching people. And you know what? Like, I'm not going to lie, boo. As of right now, I'm going back in August. Like, I want an opportunity to people watch. I want an opportunity to be around hundreds of thousands of people that I can just observe. And this is why I love doing YouTube, why I love doing these things. Because when you guys leave a comment, which you should always do, even for the algorithm gods, but I love them. I read every single comment on Snapchat. When you guys join Patreon, you get on my Snapchat. People always ask me, or they'll say things like, I don't know if you're going to see this. I'm like, boo, I'm going to see this. Like, I'm going to watch it. I want to watch it. I want to hear from you guys because I'm a person, you're a person. And there's definitely things about life that you know that I don't get to experience. I've never been to Florida. So everyone in Florida has knowledge I do not have. I want your knowledge, Florida. Even the bath salts. I want all of it. I want to know all of it. So I know how to be. I know how to reflect who I am. When I was younger, I thought this girl knew me. Because when we talked, we clicked very fast. Oh my gosh, no way. Oh my gosh, what? Stop. What? Huh? What? It was just so beautiful. Always talking, never lulls, just amazing, perfect, loved everything about her. Completely different person than I thought she was. because over time we learned, oh, we're not the same people we thought each other was because we were assuming or connecting on only this thing. It's really normal to do this. No one's a bad guy. It's pretty human. We fall in love with the fantasies of people. It's like belonging to a D&D group and your whole identity is around D&D. You might find a D&D girlfriend, all of a sudden you have D&D babies. What happens if D&D gets destroyed or a nuclear war happens? Is your whole identity that was a D&D thing ruined? It's like gymnastics. How many people are ballerinas? How many jobs were stopped during COVID and people had to have a midlife crisis about like, oh my God, I can't do my job. This is a big deal. When we choose our lives, when we choose to have our lives revolve around people who are not us in a way that overwhelms who we are, you know, because you obviously want to live a life for your family, but not for your family. And I struggle with this. I have a very specific place in the hierarchy in my family. I like where I am, but I cannot remain in this place if I'm in a marriage. So when I get married, so when I'm dating people, family takes priority, right? So if I'm seeing somebody and we're not married and we're just kind of like checking each other out, you know, and something comes up with the family, I'm going to go be with my family. If I'm married and I have kids and something comes up with the family and it's not a life or death situation, but it's enough that we need to get someone there right away. If I am not available, because it won't be when I have other things on my mind, we're going to have somebody else who can be there. It's not that I don't want to be there, but responsibilities have to shift as you take on more responsibility. It's funny. Most people I know will take on more responsibility and pile it on themselves instead of reallocating responsibility. They'll take it upon themselves. Give it to other people. Things must change. Life changes. So when you're choosing friends, it is so easy to fall in love for the superficial reasons. And I mean this with your friends, like falling in love with your friends or like having, you know, good friendships with your friends. But be realistic for the both of you. Why are you connecting? Why do you like each other? Why are you really like spending time with each other? And if it's just to not be alone, then the friendship is rooted in sort of like a weird objectification, which is valid but weird and not always healthy to do long term. We see this online with a lot of subculture communities. I'm not going to lie. The reason Twitter is so toxic or any of these subcultures are toxic. Have you guys seen all these videos? The writing community is toxic. The black community is toxic. The queer community is toxic. Everybody's fucking toxic. Yeah. Because when human beings get together in large collectives, coming around an identity or a thought process that's not really about who they are, but the time they're alive, it's not deep. It's basic. People think your war is deep. They think your tragedy is deep. They think slavery is deep. They think transness is deep. None of this is deep. Human beings, for all of their existence, have killed and done horrible things to each other, family members, others. Anytime the narrative of your life is dictated by history or the world around you, you are already at a loss. Unless you plan to stay at two. And in that case, embrace it, boo, because this is all you have. This is it. You're going to spend your one life living as a two, which is not a problem. There's nothing wrong with that. And you're going to identify heavily with an identity outside of yourself and use it to dictate your whole life. And then you're going to find friends who fit in those bubbles and match up with you and agree with you. So when you say things, you don't feel attacked or challenged. And then you're going to wake up one day when you're 62 and say, I wonder why people don't seem to get me. Maybe there's not much to get. Or maybe there's something in you to get that you don't want to admit because it'll mean you'll be alone. The weirder you are, the more alone you are. All these normal queer kids I keep seeing everywhere who I love so much, who are just so wonderful, trying so hard to be unique and weird to stand out, stop it. Do you really want to stand out and be all alone, living on a farm in the middle of nowhere because you literally can't find anyone who sees you? I mean, maybe you do. That's what hermits are for, right? But it's not a life you need to have. And yes, all of this just sounds very contradictory to you because life is little contradictions. I love dressing like this for you guys because it's a part of me that I want to do. But my most default Brittany loves sweatpants and sweatshirts. That's what I love more than anything. That's what I love being in more than anything. But at the same time, I can't deny this part of my brain. I saw this little dating meme thing that said, hold on, let me see. It's on my phone. I saw it and it made me giggle so hard because it's exactly what I want in life. But it's like this, like, it's almost like too contradictory, but it's perfect. Let's see. It says, is it really possible for an emo girl and a country boy to be in a relationship? And then it has like a cowboy with his little hat on. This is the dream. I am this little emo girl in my heart, but I look like a basic sweater girl up in like personhood, like real life, right? But then I also have a country heart. Like, I was at the smoke shop the other day. Oh, the pipe's in the bathroom. And I picked up this cattle pipe. It's on my Instagram. Check it out. I just got back on social media. I don't spend a lot of time there, but if you guys want to see some photos. So I posted this cattle pipe that I had. And the people who were there were like, whoa, you like that cattle pipe? I was like, yeah, bro, it's dope. And they were like, really? You don't seem like the kind of girl that would, like, first of all, be in a smoke shop. And second of all, be into country stuff. I was like, oh, no, I'm hella a country girl in the heart. In my heart, I'm country. And it's funny because I'm from California. So it's not like I grew up a cowgirl, but I love country. Like, I'm redesigning my living room right now to be like rustic industrial country. And it's because I love that theme. I love that space. I love that energy. It's very earthy. It's very primal. It's very, you know, dominance and submissive. It's very beautiful. It's a very wholesome culture. People have honor and rules. I like it. But I'm not always that person. Sometimes I'm this person. Sometimes I'm cosplay Brittany. Sometimes I'm BDSM Brittany. Sometimes I'm like, do you get what I'm saying? So to find people who would know all those parts of you, to get to know you over years, to know all those parts of you, to really know that they like you as a person and not just parts of you, that takes time. And it requires you to let down your walls. So when I was younger, I would put up all these walls. I wouldn't let anyone in. And then I was like, well, that's not helpful. Then I tore them all down and I let everybody in. That wasn't helpful. So now what's my rule, guys? What's my little saying? I'm in a house with a white picket fence. I have boundaries, but I'm open. I'm open, but I have boundaries. So people had asked me to talk about boundaries. How do you set boundaries down with people, especially as you're getting to know them? First, you have to set boundaries down with yourself. So as an example, I tell my girlfriends, if you're on Tinder and you notice that you are the kind of person that can't just have fuck buddies and you have a tendency to catch feelings and you don't want to move into sex too quickly, then the rule is take sex off the table. Don't put yourself in a situation where you're going to get blinded by sex. Because I personally, as a horn dog myself, am very tempted by sex. And I am a person who will have sex with people I don't even like in the right setting, with the right drugs, if I'm in the right mood. And so I don't do that anymore. I don't put myself in situations where I'm high around strangers or drunk around strangers without a drinking or high buddy, because I tend to put all the rules outside the windows and I will engage. I don't regret it the next day, except what I often regret is how special people feel and then they want more. And then that's the issue. Because when I interact with people, I try to put everything I have into that one interaction, which doesn't actually make for a long-term good solution to creating boundaries. And this is where the like religious tone sort of comes in and makes sense. When you share too much of yourself with people, when you're too intimate too quickly, it does blur the lines and confuses people. I noticed that even in BDSM and poly circles, people think they're more important than they are because they've been inside you. And I understand why, because we all hope to be important to somebody. But we're too afraid to ask outright, am I a priority in your life? Am I in your inner circle? Am I someone that you want around? My best friend said to me the other day, one of the things she loves about our friendship is that I make it abundantly clear constantly that I want her in my life. And I do this because I see the way people act in other people's lives. They don't understand that you, even though I've been friends with her for 20 years, I remind her all the time, you are my best friend. You are very important to me. You are my sister. You must stay in my life. You may not exit my existence. I need you in my life. Because I never, ever want to take for granted that we choose every day to remain friends. Same thing with my siblings, same thing with like my friends, my inner circle. I want to make sure that they know I will be very devastated if they leave. All of these people still are getting to know me. I'm still getting to know them. And as I learn every day the new things about them, it just solidifies what I knew about them before. That they're good people, they're trying their best, and they're genuinely interesting humans who have a lot of interesting ideas about the world. Even if sometimes they fall into two worlds, the way they explore even the two world is much more interesting than the other people of the world, because the other people of the world don't see me and I don't see them. It's not that they're not interesting. It's not that they're not great. But I can't get on their wavelength. We don't speak the same language. I dated a guy who was a Burning Man guy. He went every year. And I am not a Burning Man person. I wanted the idea of being one, so I started to hang out in his groups, started to put together some Burning Man preparation stuff, started to hang out with Burning Man people thinking, oh, these people are going to be awesome. They're going to know a lot about life. They're going to have introspective ideas. They're going to be philosophers. Negatory Superman. It was so boring. I mean, they literally just talked about like drugs and having sex and being naked and pissing in the desert sand, but nothing was about introspection. Nothing was about the human soul. Nothing was about what it means to be a person. They were like, oh, Brittany, you're going to love Burning Man. We have a pleasure dome, bro. And I was like, what the fuck is a pleasure dome? They're like, it's just a big fat orgy of like hundreds of people. And I was like, why would I like that? And they're like, because you're into BDSM and shit. But my BDSM is more spiritual meditation and masochism than it is sexual. So I was like, oh. And that's the thing. That's why it is so funny to me how we could have a community that seems so niche but brings in so many different kinds of people and it overlaps, which is good all the same, right? But it means we all have different reasons for being at the dungeon. And so making the assumption that we're all there for the same reason is the mistake. And when you make friends, this is the mistake I see. People assuming we're all here for the same reason, so we must be connected. It's why we're disappointed in people. It's why people are still disappointed over J.K. Rowling. Cat Black said it best. Why do y'all keep getting disappointed by the consistency of J.K. Rowling? She is pretty consistent with her beliefs. Either you like her or you don't. You know what I mean? The fact that people get hung up on it every year, the fact that every year, queer circles have to have the debate on whether or not kinks should be at Pride is, I get it, for new generations to have those conversations, but I am sort of sick of seeing my friends make the same fucking statements every year. At the end of the day, we all have very black and white ideas about the lives we want. Some of us want kink at Pride because we believe we should be there. Some people think we shouldn't because we want kids to be there. I don't care. At the end of the day, let's just admit it. We want it to be comfortable for us. And so we're all advocating for the world to be comfortable for us, which puts us at odds with other people who are supposed to be our friends because we all live in the same subcultures. But the truth is we're all individuals and we're different. Stop assuming we're all the same. Stop assuming you're the same. Acknowledge if you're weird. If you're raising your kids to be different than the other neighborhood kids, you're got the weird kid at school. I was the weird kid in homeschooling. I was homeschooled till I was 15. And I was the weird kid. I used to go up to people in homeschooling because I have to wear shorts under my dresses. And I would flash people like, you want to see my underwear? And I thought it was so funny that I had a pair of shorts underneath because the Christian moms would be like, like they'd be so afraid I was really going to show my underwear. And I thought it was so funny. And I was probably like 9, 10. I just thought it was the funniest thing ever. Right? Like I've always been the weird kid. And homeschooler kids always thought I was weird. Right? The irony when you're the weirdo amongst all the weirdos, but you're not as weird as the weird weirdos, because then there's the weird, weird weirdos. And even those people, I don't know what to do with them. But those people are usually the ones who can't be trusted with responsibility. So let's say the ones. That's how Quixote is so smart. He says the best way to explain what the ones are to people is that ones are people you can't actually give responsibility to because they can't do the simplicity of making pork right. I remember somebody in my life who was a one. I don't, you know, they're not my life anymore. Years and years ago, they made, their one job was to make dinner. So they made dinner, but it was way undercooked. And they fought with the people who they had served dinner to. They're like, it's not undercooked. The temperature thermometer said it was correct. But it was obviously undercooked if you looked at it, okay? They had not known how to use the thermometer. Put the thermometer up against the bone, which everybody knows makes a different temp. It's the wrong temp. But they argued because they couldn't imagine they had done it wrong because the simplicity of making dinner was so hard for them. They just couldn't admit it. And it's true because ones can't be given responsibility. They don't know what to do with it. They always say they want it because it's true. If you want to survive in the world of the twos, threes, fours, fives, you have to be able to handle responsibility. No matter who you are as a two, you have to at least do the basics. You get what I'm saying? So this person struggled not understanding like, it's you, homie. And he did for the rest of the night blame everybody else. It was like, well, everyone else was wrong. Oh, the thermometer was wrong. Everything else was wrong. Not him. Couldn't be him. Because how could he reach the age of whatever age and not know how to cook a steak or not know how to cook pork? Do you get what I'm saying? Let's take a break and I'll be right back. Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence? Me too! Join us on Patreon for just a dollar to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just a dollar, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye! Ooh, I'm having a bad circulation day today, so I needed more time to move my legs around. I'll show it at the end of this podcast. Just like, my legs have always been this way. I have an issue sleeping with it. It's just like poor circulation, but I'll work on it. So, okay. I talked to someone yesterday. It was a really great conversation. You remember a while back, I asked you guys to join me for some viewer me conversations. And we talked about dark romance yesterday. Such a good conversation. 100%. Can't wait to make a video on it. And we bonded over the fact that we both love Laurel K. Hamilton. Hey, girl, hey. Laurel K. Hamilton's like one of my faves. And I found her book when I was 15, sitting in a library in a public high school. I found Guilty Pleasures, which I have sitting in my closet. And I fell in love. I was like, who is this lady? Now, as I got older and started reading her books more and more, I found out more about the author. She's BDSM. She's poly. She's a great example of somebody who made life work for her. And I love that. A lot of people take issues with her books. I get it. Myself included. Like, at one point, girl got like 20 boyfriends. It's just too many. You know what I mean? But I understand the exploration of that fantasy. Now, I thought if I met people who read Laurel K. Hamilton, they would automatically be my best friend. Not always, but sometimes. Sometimes what it does is it allows us to say, oh, we're the kind of people that gravitate towards these kinds of stories. And even if we're not meant to be best friends, we are meant to have these conversations, because you cannot talk about literature that you cannot read, like a Poppy Z. Bright, a Laurel K. Hamilton, an Anne Rice, and read their most graphic writing about sex or pleasure, BDSM or masochism, and just talk about that with just anybody. You really got to have the conversation with the right audience, because these books can attract all kinds of different people. You still have to find the ones who are attracted to it for the same reason you're attracted to it. Okay. But it was so nice having that connection, to have that moment to talk to someone about literature, but not put the pressure of us being best friends or us having these connections. I mean, there's a lot of pressure that goes into socializing that I think we put on ourselves and we blame society for. And I understand the desire to do that. I do understand the desire to skip ahead when you meet someone, to say we must connect on this thing, and so we'll skip ahead to where we're all best friends. But the thing that makes friendship so important is the work that goes into it. Now, I hear this about friends in the same way I hear about lovers. Certain number twos live in bubbles where they say things like, oh, you say you want this, but you don't go for it when it's available to you. I.e., you say you want a husband, but when the perfect guy comes to you, like with 80% of what you want, you know, he's not good enough. I get what they're saying in some ways, but in other ways, I don't think they're understanding that the people who are looking for specific things do need specific things. So if you're a specific person who's specifically weird, and you need a specific thing out of a relationship or friendship, you have to know you're the odd man out. You're the loner. You're the weird person. And you have to be okay with that. In the same way that you have to be okay with the fact that the world functions on the majority for a reason. As it should, most of the time, in every way. Because most people are best served these ways, in these circles. Now, what is the solution? Communities that aren't predicated on you having to explore every part of yourself while you're in that community, while being aware that we're not exploring every part of ourselves in these communities. So the disappointment doesn't exist. So people aren't freaking out on each other. Stop going into these communities assuming that one thing about you is enough to explain everything about you. Unless you are that person, in which it does, you will be very happy. You know how many BDSMers I know who got married in the dungeon, died in the dungeon, had kids in the dungeon, did all these things in the dungeon, never left the dungeon, predicated, like created a whole life on the dungeon, and they lived perfectly happy lives. You can do this. It is an option for you. But once again, you are the odd man out. You're choosing a niche community to involve yourself in, revolve around. So you're only going to meet people in those in that world. So don't be shocked when you interact with the rest of the world and it doesn't understand you. Embrace it. Own it. But don't resent people around you for not getting you, especially if you don't get yourself. I used to have this person who would come on my YouTube channel all the time and leave a comment about how he was going to kill himself and how I'm an awful person because I won't help him for free and how I should be willing, if I really wanted to help people, to hear him out. And I told him to go to therapy and he's like, I don't have money for therapy. You should help me for free. And I was like, look, buddy, I'm not going to do this to myself. I'm not going to pretend I'm smarter than I am. I can't help you. And he was like, you're an awful person. I'm definitely going to kill myself. And he would do this often, leave me comments, and I just ignored him. You know, I thought about blocking him, but I think that makes them feel really satisfied. You ever see those leftists or the conservatives on Twitter who like, blocked by Barack Obama, blocked by Candace Owens? It's like their whole life revolves around getting blocked, and it's super weird and it's super unhealthy, and I don't trust people like that. I used to be a two. I used to do these things, like feel really like vindicated somehow. It's just like a weird sense of superiority that's super unhealthy. Do not recommend going down that road. But I know that what he was asking was for someone to see him. I know what he was asking for was for someone to care enough. So he went to the extreme of, I'm going to kill myself for attention. And I know, as a person who is suicidal herself, like what it's like to go to the internet for attention. When I was younger and in high school and in MySpace, I thought I was connecting with so many emo people because we all had the same suicidal ideations. I thought I connected. There was this author on MySpace. Please tell me if any of you know his name or remember him. He was super vain, very attractive from what I remember. And he wrote a book, and the book was like, he was very like sarcastic and very like kind of a dry humor, but also just like kind of narcissistic in a way. But he used to take pictures of everyone's picture of his book and put it in his room. And then he would like sit on a toilet and take funny photos with his books. He had all these things he would do that were just like very outlandish. But he reminded me of a Jeffree Star. And it's funny, of course, I found Jeffree Star on MySpace. We think we're connecting with people when we're on Vampire Freaks, when we're on FetLife, when we're on all these things. And then we come to people like me and go, hey, why am I on FetLife and I'm not connecting to these people? Why are they all these kinds of people? Because when you have an open space where anyone can join, you're going to run into a lot more people who aren't compatible for you than compatible. The more weird you are, the harder it's going to be. So you have to literally dissect yourself as you're dissecting other people to learn who's really the people you're going to lean on. I am shocked that I don't have any hardcore queer leftist friends in my inner circle. And at the same time, I'm not shocked at all, because if you're a hardcore queer leftist, you're not going to fuck with my energy 24/7. Because if that's all you are 24/7, that's not really going to mesh well with my energy, right? But I love my friends who are queer leftist like activists. I love hanging out with them. I love visiting them and visiting their energy. But I cannot have that amount of energy around me all the time, because it only matters in their bubble. And when your identity is only real in your bubble, it's hard to meet people outside of your bubble and in theirs. So what I try to do when people come to my space is to be like, hi, welcome to my bubble. So people know, like, it is not like the outside world. You can say a lot of things in this house and I will just be like, very interesting. I'm not here to lecture you about your politics. I'm not here because I don't care what you choose to do, because you must have been doing it for a reason. But if you come to me specifically asking, then it's going to be fun to explore. And still, even then, I didn't get the vaccine. Okay. And I'm probably not going to need to take it, because, you know, I don't take a lot of vaccines if I don't need to. I just take what I need to take if I need to take it, but I don't really need to take it. My best friend took the vaccine. Relatives took the vaccine. People took the vaccine. And it wasn't a big deal to me. Their body, their choice. Like, of course they took it. Why wouldn't they? Like, you know what I'm saying? But some people, I think, expected me, because they asked me, like, oh, are you upset she took it? And I was like, why would I be upset she took something that she wanted to take? I don't care. It is not my business. Like, what do I care? Like, I don't care. Because I know she's making the best decision she can with the information she has. And even though we disagree on whether or not we want to take it, the fact is she's allowed to make that decision. And I respect her because she understands the consequences of taking that vaccine. Whether it's nothing or something. Either way, she's accepted them. And I think that's what's important. Just like when I smoke every day and I feel my throat and I feel these two little lymph nodes getting swollen, I think to myself, they're going to be tumors one day. And I think to myself, like, I wonder if I should get screened for cancer before I get married in case my future partner doesn't want to marry somebody with lung cancer. Because I'm assuming I'm going to get it. Like, girl smokes way too much pot. You know what I mean? So to sum up everything we've talked about in the podcast, to sum up this idea of knowing if you're dealing with somebody who sees you, the ultimate answer is that it will take time, vulnerability, and honesty. And I understand, as somebody who does not show a lot of her private life, who is very private in a lot of ways, I struggle with this myself because I'm also a public figure. I don't know what it's like to be a normal person who socializes anymore. I just told one of my homies today, I said, hey, I want you. Oh, I was talking to Tracy. You guys know Tracy. Well, I told them I want to do some redecoration with their help in my house, but I only want to show three of the rooms because I know that if I show any other part of the house, I could get doxxed. And it's because I know all the ways, like, stalkers and weird people can find ways of finding your location. And because I'm dealing with my stalker, even currently, like, she, you know, she's an issue. They're always an issue, though. That's the problem, is like, they're always an issue. They're just crazy people who, like, want you to pay attention to them. So I ignore to the best of my ability. But, like, I don't want any excuse that I lay down my guard. You know what I mean? I just saw Boogie, you know, Boogie's stalker came to his house and he shot a gun up in the air to threaten him. And now Boogie's facing a felony. Like, this is what freaks me out. People showing up is not okay. And for the people who have told me, like, oh, I've been trying to figure out where you live for fun, it's not funny to me. And that's just, you know, people tell you so much about themselves without realizing it. I've taken note of every person that has casually said, I've been really trying to figure out where you live. And I'm like, note to self, weirdo. Like, but people don't know. When they say those things, they think it's normal. I went on an eHarmony date, and the guy I went on the date with gave me his first and last name. And I was like, why are you giving me your personal information? He was like, oh, and I work at this job. And I was like, why are you telling me who you are? He's like, oh, because we're on a date. And I was like, yeah, I don't need to know that much about you yet. Like, don't tell me who you are until I decide I want to see you again, and then we'll talk about who you are. I don't need to know these things. Tell me what you believe. Tell me what your ideas are so I can literally write you off on those alone, and then I can ask you about information that will allow me to stalk you later. Like, people are so normal. I forget that it's normal to give people your phone number. Oh my God. Phone numbers. Like, my phone number is sacred to me, and people out here giving people their phone numbers they met on Tinder, like, I just realized I've been a YouTuber for too many years because I can't even think like a normal person anymore. So remember, the advice I'm giving you is also from that perspective of, like, I don't know what it's like to be a normal person. I have no idea what's normal, but I most certainly cannot date like I'm normal. Like, no, thank you. Like, people don't even meet my family, know where they live, know anything about them until months of me getting to know them, me vetting them myself, especially after my stalker, especially after my bad choices in the past. No, thank you. So take what I've said with a grain of salt and remember that I do ultimately believe that vulnerability is key to intimacy, but you must be wise with how fast you share things. If you find yourself oversharing, give yourself boundaries. Think less about giving other people boundaries. Think more about giving yourself boundaries. You know you're tempted by going shopping, don't go shopping. If you're tempted by getting drunk and going out and sleeping with people you know you're going to regret, don't do it. You know, avoid temptation. Hasn't religion been telling us that for years? Avoid temptation. And be responsible. It's much easier to hold yourself accountable than to put boundaries on other people. So put the boundaries on yourself. You know what I mean? It's probably the best way to do it. And then slowly get to know someone. You know, I don't know if it's because I'm aging or because I'm just so comfortable with where I am in life, but I would be happy getting to know someone for like a year to 2 years before I ever physically wanted to meet them or gave them my phone number. And because we have online communities where that's possible, I don't think that's that odd. Like, do you remember how Corpse recently allowed, what's that Asian guy's name? I don't know his name because I don't watch him. But the Asian guy with the cute hair, whatever, he's like, corpse met him. And everyone's like, wow, why'd you let him meet you? It's like, I don't know these answers. I don't know why certain people allow certain people into their lives. But there is, without a doubt, when you are restrictive or limited, people feel special automatically by getting to know you. And that's also a thing that I know as a YouTuber, but I'm not sure if that's a normal person problem. So like as a YouTuber, I might allow someone into my life because I'm getting to know them as a person, but they might think, oh, this is a really big deal because she never does this, which is true. It is a big deal, but that doesn't mean you're a big deal. It just means I was in a mood where I was open to getting to know somebody, but it doesn't mean like you become important automatically. Because for me, like, again, I meet so many people so often, it feels almost like another day for me until it doesn't. So again, when you're hearing me talk, just remember who I am and my life experience, and then put it against your life experience and what might work for you. Leave me follow-up questions if you guys don't mind in the comment sections down below. I'm sure there's something else we could have talked about here, but I hate when weird people don't acknowledge they're weird, because I don't understand why weird people want to appeal to the masses. You know what I mean? If you're weird enough, they won't even know you exist. Unless you go around telling people. All right. Have a great day, guys. I'll talk to you soon. And yeah, I'm going to go. All right. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed. My belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, 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 dun.